against Bill Cosby ends in a hung jury. Despite deliberating 55 hours, the jury deadlocked and the judge called a mistrial, but Cosby's team treats it like an exoneration.
Ultimately, that is a manifestation of justice based on facts, not lies.
But is it actually over? The prosecutors say they intend to retry the case. And the president has declared war on the number two man in the Justice Department. Might Rod Rosenstein be fired or forced to recuse himself in the Russia probe? And on the eve of Megyn Kelly's NBC interview with him, controversial radio host Alex Jones starts leaking tapes that he secretly made of her promises during negotiations. Is he already getting the last word?
It's not going to be some gotcha hit piece, I promise you that.
Plus, did a recent caller to my radio program give a major insight into the 2020 campaign? And many of you tweeted last week asking if I'd been canceled or fired. The answer is, I was busy dancing, and I'll explain. But first, Wednesday's attempted massacre of Republican members of Congress was horrific. Paul Ryan was right to say that it was an attack on all members of Congress. That the shooter was motivated by hatred of the president and his party seems incontrovertible, nor the fact that it comes in the context of a poisonous political climate that's been building for years. Sadly, many now are being selective in their condemnation of incivility by focusing only on the left or only on the right. And that's a tell. Those who single out only one extreme are themselves part of the problem. There's plenty of bad behavior to go around, and it's been this way for far too long. I have often spoken and written about the disrespect that President Obama faced for all 8 years. Here's just one column I wrote, 2012. In that piece, I noted, quote, "It's been unrelenting. The day after Obama took office, Rush Limbaugh told Sean Hannity that he wanted him to fail. Later, Glenn Beck called the president a racist with a deep-seated hatred of white people. Donald Trump's birtherism took hold, while words like socialist were uttered with increased frequency. And now, already on his watch, President Trump has faced criticism that has been over the top, which I've also noted. The Kathy Griffin ISIS-style pose with Trump's decapitated head was disgusting, and CNN was right to fire her, as well as Raisa Aslan, who on Twitter called Trump a piece of excrement. In a commentary that I delivered here on May 6, I even took issue with Stephen Colbert, telling an oral sex joke about Trump and Putin. I said that, quote, intolerance has a way of catching up with you politically, unquote. And in a play in Central Park showing the execution of a Trumpian figure, I've said that too is over the top. All sides need to agree that the climate has been calamitous and that words can have consequences. Many said on Wednesday that the baseball field shooting will be a game changer, no pun intended. That'd be nice, but pardon my pessimism. 6 years ago, Congresswoman Gabby Giffords was shot outside a Safeway grocery store in Arizona, and similar sentiments were said, but nothing changed. That's partly due to the fact that there are many factors driving our discourse, institutional factors that need fixing or nothing will change. Sure, it begins with the politicians, but the way that we select those individuals limits the candidate pool. The role of dark money, closed primaries, gerrymandering, self-sorting, and the outsized role of media personalities who are rewarded for bombast, not substance. Their livelihoods depend on fomenting division. Not diplomacy, so don't go looking to them to lead. While we seek to rein in the extremists, we must be careful not to stymie legitimate inquiry and debate. The shooting came on the same day as the Washington Post breaking the news that the president is under investigation by special counsel Robert Mueller for possible obstruction of justice, and President Trump seemed to confirm that himself with a tweet. That revelation should not have surprised anyone who's been paying attention. Matter of fact, I immediately tweeted the following. This is no surprise. Where POTUS fired the person conducting an investigation into possible collusion by his campaign. In light of Jim Comey's testimony that he believed he was being directed by the president to drop the probe of Michael Flynn, Mueller would be derelict in his duty not to look at the president's behavior. According to the sworn testimony of the former FBI director, the president sought a loyalty commitment, excused the vice president and attorney general from the Oval Office before asking Comey to let go of the Flynn probe, fired him after he didn't drop it, and then boasted that he'd relieve pressure. That's all worthy of impartial investigation, which should not be lost in the grief over the Wednesday shooting. Joining me now, Peter Wallison, who was White House counsel to President Ronald Reagan and wrote this piece for The Wall Street Journal. Comey closes the case almost, which says the president cannot be guilty of obstruction of justice unless he attempts to obstruct an investigation of himself, as in Watergate. Mr. Wallison, if the president should now fire Rosenstein, is that obstruction of justice?
We don't have any idea whether the president would fire Rosenstein. What the president said didn't indicate that he would fire Rosenstein. This is just a lot of useless speculation at this point. And whether he fired Rosenstein, if he did, would be obstruction of justice only if it is found that the president ultimately had committed some kind of crime. And thus far,
in other words,
there's no indication at all that the president has committed any crime. And you link together lead-in a whole lot of things that didn't indicate anything serious about the president's activity, at least criminal activity.
Okay, then, well, let's go there. Let's go there. Let's go to the timeline, because I think the timeline is telling. By the way, I want to make clear to you and the audience, I am not here to argue for or against a case of obstruction of justice. I just want to understand and have my audience understand the potential elements. Here's the chronology. You know that January 27 one-on-one meeting with FBI Director Comey, where the president apparently seeks a loyalty pledge. The only loyalty that Comey owed was to the United States Constitution, right? I mean, wasn't that an error by the president?
No, it was an error of a protocol, perhaps, because there has grown up the idea that many officials of the government, of the executive branch, are somehow independent of the president. But no, the executive branch of the United States would not function if the people in the executive branch were not loyal to the president, because he relies on them to carry out his orders and to provide information to him that he needs to execute his duties. So there was nothing unusual about his request for loyalty. Also, this whole Flynn thing that you linked together doesn't make a lot of sense to me. He did ask about Flynn, and he probably shouldn't have asked about Flynn. But he did, and he only asked once. And he didn't say, I want you to stop the investigation of Flynn. He said, I hope you can see your way clear to end this thing. This is not a direction from the president to the FBI director, and the FBI director taking it as a direction was wrong. So we really have very little to say about Flynn.
Okay, this was the February 14. Let's go back to the chronology. This is the Valentine's Day meeting, Mr. Wallison, where you know that the president apparently asks the vice president, Mike Pence, and the attorney general to leave the Oval Office. That sounds nefarious to some, and then says, I hope you can let go of the Flynn probe, which Comey himself testified he took as a directive. Look, if I say, I hope I don't have to break your legs, I mean, that can have a connotation of criminality, no?
Sure, it could if you try to make it that, but there's nothing criminal or even suspicious about that. He wanted to talk to Comey privately because he had some feeling, apparently, for Flynn. And he didn't say, I want you to stop the investigation of Flynn. He said, I hope you can see your way clear to do that. And then, as I said before, he never mentioned it again. He had many other conversations with Comey after that, but he never talked about this issue again. So it wasn't something that he really had on the top of his mind. What he had on the top of his mind in talking to Comey was the fact that the Comey had said on March 20 that the president, that the campaign of the president was under investigation by the FBI for collusion with Russia. But the president was not a target. He had never said that. He left that open as though the president was a target.
Trump, you say
obviously,
he never,
not think, what, may I finish first?
Sure.
Trump obviously thinks that there was nothing in this charge of collusion. And so after the FBI director tells Congress that his campaign, the president's campaign, is under investigation, he should have said, but the president is not a target. The president then asked him, after he had made that statement to Congress about investigating the campaign, the president said to him, well, could you please say, as you have told me, that I'm not a target? And Comey would not do that. I think that's why the president fired him.
Put the chronology back on the screen, and let me provide a contrarian interpretation. It goes like this. January 27, he seeks a loyalty oath from Comey, and he doesn't get it. On the 14th, he says,
he did not ask for a loyalty oath.
He told him he needed his loyalty. I mean, that's what Jim Comey said. That's what Comey's memo apparently will substantiate.
Right.
But let me just finish. Wait,
that's not a loyalty oath, guys.
Hold on. Mr. Wilson, I promise you, I'm all about dialogue. You'll be able to respond. The 27th, he seeks loyalty. I'll say it like that. The 14th, he says, I hope you can let go of Flynn. Apparently, thereafter, he asks the intel heads, Coates and Rogers, if they can lift the cloud. You say he only brought up Flynn one time. He never brought it up again, to which I would respond, well, he didn't bring it up again. He fired Comey on the 9th. And then on the 10th, he says, I got rid of the nut job, and I did it to relieve pressure. Which sounds like he did it to relieve the pressure of the investigation. Is that not in total a colorable case for obstruction of justice? Please respond.
No. I will respond by saying no, it is not a colorable case for obstruction of justice. It's a linking together of a whole lot of unrelated events that are not desirable to have in to present to the public in the way you are, but it happens to be true. And Trump, unfortunately, gets in his way, his own way, many times by saying things that presidents normally don't say. But this does not make any case of obstruction of justice, at least in my view. And the idea that you would say that the president of the United States committed obstruction of justice and in that way start a procedure in Congress, which would be an impeachment procedure, that would further interfere with his doing his job and perhaps even overturn the results of an election on the basis of these very weak evidential points is incredible to me. And I don't think would ever happen. It's inconceivable.
Mr. Wilson, thank you for being here. I wanted to be clear, and anybody who watched, I think, would know, I didn't just say that he committed obstruction of justice. I assembled the potential elements of such a claim, and frankly, I'm relying on a former FBI director. It's not as if I created them out of whole cloth. I thank you, sir, so much for being here. What are your thoughts? Tweet me at Smerconish or go to my Facebook page, and I will read some responses throughout the course of the program. What